Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Work Retreat by S. L. Harker. Narrated by Nikki Zakocs. Chapter 1. Is there anything more destructive than obsession? The kind that destroys your sense of right and wrong, that seeps into every thought, making it impossible to think straight? I'm at our annual work retreat with my colleagues sitting around me, and all I can see is him, my married boss, the man I can't stop crushing over. It's sick. It's stupid. I'm 30, and I should know better. But I guess that's what happens when you've been a walking wound for so long. Nathan's eyes stumble onto mine. It's a brief millisecond at best, but electric heat bolts up my spine like a firecracker. I'm the first to break eye contact, shuffling my gaze to my lap as warmth spreads from my neck to my face. I'm sure I'm the color of a ripe tomato, and a whole room of my coworkers are here to witness my shame. He clears his throat and speaks, the vibrato of his voice dripping like sap through the small banquet room.
So, folks, we are going to try this team-building exercise to see where we stand with the marketing process for several products. We're projecting major sales this month, but it all depends on how we get our ads out there to the key demographics.
I keep my chin down, my eyes focused on the white triangle print of my navy blue dress. Sweat dampens the fabric, making it stick to my skin. What happened to the air conditioning? I purposefully look at my colleagues instead of my boss, Vivian, who is all dark hair and good skin. Seriously, in her mid-40s, she's more gorgeous than ever. She nods along as Nathan speaks. Be like Vivian. Do your job. The thing is, I'm trying to earn my stripes here at Cutler Stewart, a mid-size advertising company. At 30, I'm the junior member of the marketing team, and a lot of the time, I feel as if some of the more seasoned employees are sizing me up, figuring out whether I'll sink or swim. Chet scoffs at something Nathan says and pulls me back to reality. Whether the sound is intentional or not, it's hard to tell. I sense Nathan's spine straightening and his cobalt blue eyes darkening into storm clouds. A ripple of tension slips across his jawline.
Is there some insight you'd like to add to the group? Nathan asks Chet.
Janine's mouth makes an O. So much tension has been building between Chet and Nathan, and now, in this cheap room in a cheap hotel 2 hours outside Chicago, it ripples to the surface. But Chet is never ruffled or embarrassed. He shrugs.
No, carry on.
Then he grins and adds, boss. Nathan is our team leader. He organized the retreat. Considering the tension within the team, he thought it would be a good idea for us to get out of the office. But seriously, did he have to bring us to this bumfuck town in the middle of nowhere? I don't think I've seen a single stoplight here.
Well, thank you, Chet. I will.
We all cringe now. I pick up a pen and tap it lightly against the polished mahogany table. Even though I am relatively new to the game, I've heard whispers that Chet is prepared to steal Nathan's job out from under him. The atmosphere thickens, and the two men stare at each other as if wanting to put the other in checkmate. My stupid lizard brain turns this red flag into a green one. I can't help but think Nathan is hot when he's mad about something. Anger suits him. He's 45, but he could pass for 35. He already looks like an Abercrombie and Fitch model, and the temper gives him an edge. He's clean-shaven and tall, with impeccable jet-black hair slicked into a neat side part. Chet's smile is snide, as he shakes his head and wipes his mouth with the handkerchief that he plucked from the breast pocket of his expensive black suit. He has a mop of wavy chestnut hair. Nathan cuts him a dubious glance, but continues. He reaches for his own water glass, his hands once again brushing mine, making my skin tingle. I examine the documents in front of me, determined to focus on the tasks at hand, but it's going to be a major challenge to keep it together. My mom died several weeks ago. Since then, I've been aware of this gaping hole that never existed before. The world is off kilter, and the only way I can write it again is to fill the hollowness inside. Before Mom died, I knew I liked Nathan, but I wasn't obsessed like I am now. I crave him, hoping that being with someone I really like will fill the abyss. I want to stop thinking about death. I need to feel alive again and forget about the disease that took her away. After the meeting, Nathan takes us all to the hotel bar to chill. It's obvious he feels guilty about snapping at Chet. Personally, I think Chet's sucky attitude is his own problem. The neon sign on the adjacent wall glows brightly. Blue and yellow light dances across the surface of the bar. I order a martini and consider downing it. Vivian perches like a parrot on her stool, her shoulders stiff. I try to think of how to carry on a conversation with her without it involving tons of awkward silences. We've never been close. "What did you make of the meeting?" I ask. She picks at a beer label with a thumbnail. "Whatever Nathan wants, I guess." Pretty noncommittal. Part of me wonders if I should pick a side, figuring out who is for Chet and who is for Nathan. "Do you think Chet wants Nathan's job? It got really tense in there." Vivian lets out a snort. "Don't worry. They'll measure each other's dicks soon enough and put the whole business to bed." I can't help it. I burst into a fit of giggles. Vivian isn't usually so sassy. Our laughter brings Nathan over. He pulls out a bar stool to my left, its metal legs skidding across the wood-planked floor. In the background, a country song plays from an illuminated jukebox.
"Having fun?"
he asks. I bite my lower lip, trying not to think about Nathan and Chet with rulers. I nod, and Vivian fails to smother a laugh. "I'm going to call it a night." She casts a glance at Chet, who is sitting with Janine, eyeballing us. "Three beers are enough for me." When she's out the door, Nathan raises an eyebrow.
"She drank three beers in a half hour?"
"Yep," I say, smiling. "Vivian does not play." He laughs and shakes his head. To our left, a group of bearded, flannel-clad men play pool. Nathan plants his elbows on the bar.
"So, are you having fun? Or do I suck at this cool boss at work retreat thing?"
"I'm having fun. You don't suck." I tuck a lock of hair behind my ear. "But why the hell did you choose this place?" He laughs.
"I got a good deal. The company is trying to save money."
I nod. "I figured." Nathan glances in Chet's direction.
"It's not common knowledge, so don't spread it around."
"I won't."
"Though, I guess it's obvious."
Nathan nudges his chin toward the bartender.
"I'll take a whiskey sour, another round of whatever she's having."
"Martini." Nathan's eyes glint. He studies me as if seeing me for the first time.
"Nice choice. You're pretty bold, aren't you, Lucy Croft?"
He's flirting with me. Nathan has never flirted with me before. My face warms with embarrassment. "I guess." Bold has never been a word applied to me. Bookish, yes. Shy? Yes. Stupid? Okay, that's my word.
"You had some great ideas earlier," Nathan says,
bringing the rim of his whiskey glass to his lips.
Thank you. I enjoy the job.
You're natural, Nathan says.
At advertising? I grin.
Lucky me, of all the things to be good at. Nathan catches my eye, and he lets out a chuckle. I like this side of him. There is something easygoing about Nathan when he's not in work mode. He shifts his weight, and his musky scent invades my personal space. My heart gallops. His eyes reach mine and linger. When he gives me that charming smile, it's like staring into the surface of the sun.
We're going back to our rooms.
Chet's voice breaks the tension. I almost let out a sigh of relief.
Sorry again, Chet, Nathan says. I didn't mean to snap. See you both at breakfast.
Chet and Janine wave goodbye and head out of the bar. I like Janine, but I worry about her hanging around Chet. He's not a gentleman. Don't apologize to that douche canoe, I blurt. Nathan stares at me. Oh, shit. I called my colleague a douche canoe in front of my very temperamental boss. Shit, shit, shit. He lets out the biggest belly laugh I've ever heard. It spreads to me, and I find myself tearing up. It's a good minute or so before we both calm down.
Chet's not so bad, Nathan says once the laughter fit fades out. But I wish he'd stop with all the macho crap, you know?
I sip my martini. The air settles around us. From nowhere, Nathan reaches across and places his hand over mine.
I don't know if I've said this, but I was so sorry to hear about your mom. Obviously, I didn't know her, but I lost my mom when I was young. It's a loss I never recovered from.
His words hit me like a sledgehammer. My eyes fill, and I sniff, trying desperately to stop the tears from falling. One escapes, and Nathan leans over, stroking it away with his pinky. I exhale a slow breath and whisper, "Thank you." As we lock eyes, I know this isn't going to end well. How could it? He's my boss. He has a wife. There's nothing more destructive than out-of-control obsession. And here's the thing. I'm not in control anymore. Chapter 2. The martini isn't doing me any favors. I mean, technically, it is helping soothe the butterflies pattering around inside my stomach every time Nathan's eyes burn into mine. But it's also lowering my inhibitions, making me feel like my insides are made of gooey caramel. As we remain in the hotel bar, chatting, I try not to appear desperate. Yet my eyes drift to his large, strong hands, noting the way he cradles the glass of whiskey. I pull my hair to one side, letting the nape of my neck cool. After my third martini, I realize I'm openly flirting. He's good company. He maintains eye contact as we talk. He's engaging, but he doesn't interrupt.
Has anyone ever told you that you have the most beautiful hair?
Heat floods my cheeks. I watch him watching me, his hand half lifted as though to touch my hair. No, I say. And it's true. While my hair is a soft shade of red now, back at school it blazed like fire, and all the school kids called me Ginger. He clears his throat.
Damn, the whiskey is good here. I've had too many, I think. Sorry, Luce. I should go to my room before...
Before what? I think. But I don't say it out loud. My martini glass is empty, and my legs are wobbly. It's time for me to go, too. I wait a moment or two, and then follow him out of the bar. When I see him waiting for the elevator, I almost head toward the stairs. But then I don't. I stand next to him. He doesn't say a word. The bell chimes, the doors part, and we step into the small space together. Nathan stands at one side of the elevator, and I stand at the other, We don't look at each other. We can't. I wonder if his heart is beating as fast as mine.
Are you on the fifth floor?
His voice croaks, and he swipes his forehead with the back of his hand. It comes away glistening.
Yes,
I whisper. The bell chimes. We stumble out of the elevator. We are side by side. His hand grazes mine.
Fuck, fuck, fuck.
There's a slight ridge in the carpet and I lose my balance, stumbling into him. The body contact is all we need. He spins me around until my palms are flat against his chest. He gazes down at me as if I'm a snack, or a full-out meal. It's a mistake, my mind says. Don't do it. And then his hands are in my hair. My arms are around his neck. I tilt my head and lift my chin. My eyelids flutter, and before I can inhale, my lips collide with his. Nathan tastes like honey and salt. His breath is cool on my cheek. His fingers tunnel through my hair. He groans, pinning me against the wall. Then nothing. He pulls away first. I stand there, embarrassed, my hair mussed and dress rumpled. He takes me in like he's in a daze, staring at me with his wild eyes.
What are we doing?
He says as though to himself.
Sorry, I whisper. You're right. We should... You're my boss, and...
The alcohol surges through my veins, yet I feel sharp as a tack, as if everything is in focus. I start to walk away, but Nathan cuffs his hand over my wrist and pulls me back.
Wait, Lucy, I... Oh, fuck it.
Our bodies clash together, a tangle of hands and mouths. Somehow, we make our way down the hall. Nathan grabs a hotel key card from his pocket, and we cross the threshold into his room. He leaves the light off, with nothing but moonlight to guide us. I concentrate on touch, the ruggedness of his large hands palming my breasts under my dress, the way his fingers slip sensually under my panties with an urgency that leaves me trembling. His touch is like icy heat between my legs, making me lightheaded.
Fuck, you're hot,
he murmurs. His breath is feverish as he exhales against my cheek. His hands journey to my waist, shoving my dress up around my hips. He pins me to the wall again, pressing his weight against me. I let out a sigh of pleasure as his hands circle my wrists. His mouth is hungry on mine. My teeth sink into his bottom lip. He groans, almost growling. He drops my wrists to pull the dress over my head. A second later, one hand reaches behind me to unclasp my bra. Then my legs are around his waist as he lifts me with ease. Hands weave through my hair. His jacket comes off, followed by his tie, guided by my fingers. I fumble through the buttons, finally feeling his warm flesh, my nails raking down his shoulder blades. And like that, half undressed, he carries me to the bed. From here, we're only two silhouettes intertwined under the milky moonlight streaming in from the cracks in the curtains. We could be anyone. And this is what I choose to think about as he buries his head between my legs and his lips part my sensitive flesh. His tongue finds my throbbing clit, and he gives the swollen area gentle kisses that make me moan, arch my back, and press my thighs around his head. As I reach the point of no return, he slows down the insistence of the kisses, most definitely to edge me on purpose. His tongue glides in glorious mind-melting circles, parting my crevices and folds. I dig my heels into his torso, and my climax violently shudders from me, a breathy moan escaping my lips. Now that my eyes have adjusted to the light, I see that Nathan is grinning, his eyes gleaming under the silver moon. I wonder whether this is the way he looks at his wife when he makes love to her, or if he has saved this enthusiasm only for me. The thought makes my stomach flip, and I push it away. His kisses don't lose their luster as he snakes his way back up to my face, his lips leaving a trail from my navel to my bare breasts. He undresses quickly, His movements are desperate as he reaches for a condom, then tosses his wallet aside, along with his pants. He sheaths the condom on and whispers in my ear that we need to be careful. I nod as his fingers spread across my hips, and he turns me around so that I'm on all fours, facing the headboard. I feel him, swollen and pulsing on my inner thighs. I want him so badly I could scream. I brace my hands on the headboard for support as he enters me and grinds our hips together. Slowly at first, and then blissfully, he cranks it up a notch. I can't see his face. I want to see him, to hold his gaze, but when I turn to face him, he grabs hold of my hair and pulls back my head. I let out a gasp of surprise. He holds me so tight I can barely move, and then he thrusts, each time shoving me deeper and deeper into the bed. This is what I wanted. I wanted him inside me. Is it everything I hoped for? He pushes my face down into the sheet, his weight pressing on top of me. My hands ball the soft cotton, and I'm lost in him, in myself, and in the world. Panic rushes through me at the realization of what I'm doing. I feel his body stiffen. His cock is rock hard inside me. He groans, squeezes my ass, and he slams into me, hard, grunting, until he's completely on top of me, and it's over. He collapses beside me. Slowly, I pull myself out from the sheet, tugging it over my naked body. Nathan disappears into the bathroom, no doubt to clean himself up. What have I done? I know what I did. I fucked my boss. I fucked my married boss.
You okay?
I didn't hear him come back into the room, but he climbs into the bed, naked. He lifts a fatigued arm and sweeps the hair away from my eyes and cheeks. The gesture is tender, sweet. I'm okay, I reply. I was miles away.
Listen, I want you to know that didn't come out of nowhere. I do like you.
Thanks. That means a lot, I reply. And I mean it. But it's okay. If you want, if this is all... I give up trying to explain myself and I place a hand on my forehead.
I know.
He kisses the tip of my nose. He turns over and pulls me into his body. I twist myself so that we spoon, and for a moment, I can pretend we're more than boss and employee, man and mistress. I can pretend we're together like a real couple. Tomorrow, my mind will be ransacked by guilt. In the light of day, it will be different for me and for Nathan. But for now, in the darkness, I'll let him reach for my hand and hold it. I'll stay naked with him, reveling in how good it feels to get caught up in the fantasy, ignoring the dread sitting low and sour in the pit of my belly. I glance up at the digital clock face on the bedside table. The time reads 2:08. Mom always told me that nothing good ever happened after 2 in the morning. I can't help but think she was right. Chapter 3. I know it's still early because it's dark. It takes me a moment to acclimatize, especially with the sleeping lump beside me, Nathan. His chest rises and falls, nice and steady. Not sure why it tickles me to see he's a stomach sleeper. My head throbs, reminding me of the 3, or was it 4, martinis I drank last night. I glance at the sharp red numbers of his bedside clock. It's 5:09. Careful not to disturb the bed too much, I peel the sheets away from the lower half of my body, cringing when I realize I'm still naked. How could I have allowed this to happen? Fragments of our steamy, sexy encounter ambush my mind out of nowhere. Nathan's hands on my breasts. His mouth hungrily devours mine. His breath tickling my cheek and neck as he groaned in my ear. The musky scent of his intoxicating cologne. The weight of him as he pressed me deep into the bed and how I enjoyed surrendering to him. Yet even then, I felt something alongside the lust, a recognition that beamed brighter at 5 in the morning than it had last night. We didn't just fuck. It was frenzied, almost unhealthy. I can't strip the images from my mind. They haunt as much as titillate. I find myself reeling, hurrying away from the bed. I need to get out of this room. I remind myself to go stealthily. I don't want Nathan to wake up and see me leaving. I want to slip out like a ghost in the night, leaving without a trace. As my eyes adjust to the darkness, I scan the room for my dress and locate it in a corner next to Nathan's side of the bed. I pad around the end of the bed and step up in front of him. Nathan grunts and rubs his face, making a low snorting sound. I freeze in place, afraid he will open his eyes and see me standing there, naked. But he doesn't. He rolls over, coughs, and tugs the sheets up around his body. I exhale a slow, quiet breath, reach down for my dress, and pluck it from the floor. I sling the garment over my head in the darkness. After tiptoeing to the door, I check once more behind me and gently turn the handle. I allow myself a quick sigh of relief when I'm out of that room. The lights are harsh and bright in the hallway. It could be a spotlight, like I'm on stage, unclothed, and the audience is made up of disgruntled wives. "Here she is," says the host, "the woman who sleeps with married men." I picture them booing and throwing rotten fruit, and I would deserve it. Back in my own hotel room, I get a good look at my reflection. I'm a hot mess. I have what Granny Croft called raccoon eyes from smudged mascara. I've never seen my hair this frizzy before, and that's impressive considering the natural waves I inherited from said grandma. The navy dress I ironed before packing is wrinkled and sweat-stained. Worst of all, a dull migraine pulses between my eyes and temples. What the hell is wrong with you? I glare at my mirror self, then twist on the shower nozzle and stare at my reflection until the steam from the hot water cloaks me like a heavy fog. I embrace the mist, wanting to disappear into it, leaving all my shame behind. "You aren't touching your fruit," Vivian notes, pointing to the colorful plate that I got from the free breakfast buffet. "Huh?" I blink at her, my fingers coiled around a warm mug of coffee. I've decided that coffee is my new best friend. I've broken up with martinis. They lead to bad, bad decisions. Also, coffee is the only thing settling my queasy stomach. "Holy fuck! What the hell happened to you?" She parks her behind on the chair next to mine. "Do I look that awful?" "Yes, honey, you do. What happened last night?" I freeze. While changing before breakfast, I toyed with the idea of leaving so I didn't have to face Nathan again. But then everyone might guess what happened between us. I figured staying to face the music would be my least suspicious action, but I hadn't factored in how obvious my hangover would be. "Martinis," I say. "I don't know what came over me." "You and Nathan were getting pretty cozy when I left." "Ew," I say, recoiling. "Actually," I lean closer, "I kind of went back to my room with one of those cowboys. You know, the pool guys."
"Ooh, you bad girl,"
Vivian grins. "Do not tell anyone," I say, wagging a finger. Vivian places a hand on her chest.
"I would never."
Well, I guess that's one issue dealt with for now. I'm going to have to suck it up and get through the rest of this nightmare as best I can. I've already vowed to myself that I'm going to avoid Nathan at all costs. I don't need to keep going down this road. The stakes are too high. Too many people, myself included, could end up hurt.
"Don't you want it?"
she asks, gesturing to the food on my plate. My eyes shift downward. "Oh, well, I'm not as hungry as I thought."
"Can I have it then?"
"Sure." I push the plate in her direction.
"Rough night?"
Janine asks, approaching the table, her gaze set on me. I groan.
"Not you too. Seriously?"
Her long, shiny black hair is perfectly blown out, as usual. Her face is glowing, cheeks rosy, and eye makeup impeccable. Janine slides into the empty chair beside me, and I bristle, hoping she doesn't notice. Her perfume is flowery and pleasant, but cloying when combined with my hangover. Janine is the office administrator. She's even younger than I am, early 20s, and she's full of energy. Too much energy for me to handle when I'm hungover and questioning my life choices.
Yeah, me too, sort of, she says.
Vivian chimes in.
Lucy took a cowboy back to her hotel room.
I lift my hands in the air.
Are you for real?
What?
It's just us girls. I thought you meant don't tell Nathan.
No, Vivian. I meant do not tell anyone. But the truth is, Vivian did me a favor. Janine loves drama and would have interrogated me anyway. Now, at least, she has an answer to her inevitable questions. Janine's blue eyes widen, and her lipstick-painted mouth forms a perfect oval when she squeals. She bumps her shoulder into mine.
One of the pool guys, huh? The cute one with the sandy hair?
I slink back into my chair and swallow hard, staring at my lap. Yep. My heart hammers, worried Janine will see through my bold-faced lie, but she swirls her coffee stick around in her cup and gives me a superficial pout, her eyes lighting up.
So, did he text?
What? I ask, distracted by a wave of nausea.
You got his number, right?
Actually, no. It was a one-time thing. She rubs my back, purring, clearly delighted to learn I failed to make the guy interested enough to get my number.
Oh, that's okay, sweetie. Maybe next time, she says in a satisfied tone.
If she only knew that I'd slept with our boss. No, she can never know. I shrug.
Oh well, it's fine.
Janine bobs her head up and down as if she's trying to relate to me, but I see right through it. She is competitive as all hell with other women. Now she gets to see herself as superior for always getting a guy to call the next day. It's written all over her face. Well, whatever distracts her from finding out I slept with Nathan. I push myself away from the table, balancing the coffee in one hand and sliding my purse over my shoulder with the other.
We should get to the first team-building exercise.
Sure. I guess I'd better hurry up. Janine grins at me and winks.
Maybe I can be your wing woman at the bar tonight, and we can both score. I need to get laid. Bad.
I didn't need to know that, but I give her a commiserative smile. Through clenched teeth, I say,
Yeah, maybe.
Knowing I have no intention of setting foot outside my hotel room after working hours. Last night was too close for comfort. They all saw me chatting and drinking with Nathan at the bar. If they hadn't bought my story about the guy playing pool, they would have guessed what really happened for sure. And then what? Would I lose my job? Or worse, would it break up Nathan's marriage? There's no way Chet wouldn't jump on the opportunity to use it to his advantage. It's time for me to backpedal on my mistakes. For the duration of this trip, it's going to be nothing but cheesy Lifetime movies on the TV while I scarf Chinese takeout straight from the carton on my hotel bed.
Chapter 4. At every team-building exercise, I make sure to sit as far away from Nathan as possible. I never dare to make eye contact with him, and I don't offer insight on any ideas unless I'm in a group setting where Nathan isn't involved. Miraculously, I get through every icebreaker and trust exercise, every brainstorming session, every problem-solving task. And he clearly has the same idea. I'm almost offended by how far away from me he stays. Until, of course, I think about his wife and kids. By the end of it all, I'm like a tightly stretched rubber band ready to snap. All I want is to go home and forget this ever happened. Only that it's impossible because I'm still plagued with the vivid memories of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.